Good morning. How are you this morning? Good, good, good. Now, do me a favor. I noticed you changed to a whole new section. That's very confusing to pastors. When you sit in one section and then you move to another. I had a group of kids. I had been at the church in Miami, I think, for 9 years. And it was my last Sunday there. And the kids came in, and they were ushers that Sunday, and they told to everybody, you cannot sit in the pew you sit in. Go to the opposite side of the church and sit in the same place you sit. So everybody from this side moved over to here, and everybody from this side. And I told them I was going to preach like this. There are a couple of announcements. Don't forget to sign the pads and pass those down. There is really good news. Pastor Harry will be home next week. Hallelujah. Preaching 2 weeks in a row is hard. In a row is hard work, folks. I didn't sign up for this when I retired. He is out visiting his mother. It was not an emergency or anything. It was planned. His sister needed a break to go see family. And so he said he'd come and sit with mom for the time that she was gone. So nothing's the matter. He just, needed to be out there and spend time with his mom. Our prayer focus for this week is for all the folks who are lonely. I don't know if you realize this or not, but this is that season when folks who don't have loved ones find it really hard. Because everything's about family now, isn't it? Gathering of friends, gathering of families. There are some folks that don't have any family to gather with. They don't have anybody close enough to come and be there at Christmas, that kind of thing. So pray for those who are going to be lonely in this season. It's a tough time of the year for them. There's a prayer group tomorrow. They meet here in the back at 8:30. Pastor Harry won't be here, but you need to be here anyways. And pray for us and remember the prayer needs. The church family. The college students, we need those names. Student that's off someplace, we're in need of that name so we can send them stuff. That would be appreciated. And the angel tree is not a tree. It's this little square thing over here that's black, and you can see there's still a few things that are on there. Go by and pick those up. Check if you've not had a chance to do that. They need to be back by the 17th of December. That's 2 weeks away, if I'm not mistaken. So we need to go ahead and get those things up. Frank, where are you at? Raise your hand. If you're interested in helping out with the Nomads or learning more about that, talk to Frank Conover. They're going to be here January 1st, helping and doing things in our community and around the church. So greatly appreciated, and I know that Frank's always needs some help with that. There's always bunch of the things going on. So are there announcements I have forgotten? Kyle's not here, and she in the first service I looked at her and she said, I'm not responsible anymore. Let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Hear these words from Isaiah 60, verse 2 to 3. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples. But the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn.
We light this candle as a symbol of Christ, our hope. May the light sent from God shine in the darkness to show us the way of salvation. O come, Emmanuel.
And now please stand for our call to worship.
Give ear to us, O Shepherd of Israel.
Restore us, O God, let your face shine.
Please remain standing for our gathering hymn this morning, number 196, Come, Thou Long-Expected Jesus. Together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Emmanuel, Emmanuel. Please
Amen.
Be seated.
You may be seated. In my very first congregation, it was a little bit smaller than this congregation. It was at Shingle Creek, and the sanctuary was about this size. See, I did do better as time went on. I mean, you know. But there was a lady who came up to me Sunday that we were there, and she kind of looked like she was, you know, not doing so well. And I said, "I'm glad you came here today." And I put my arms around her and I gave her a hug. For the next 2 years, every Sunday, that was the kind of ritual we went through. And after 2 years had passed, she stood kind of back and let everybody else leave. And she came and she said, "You know, for the last 2 years, you've given me a hug every time, you know, service has been over with." I said, "I know, I'm sorry. I'm a touchy-feely person. If you don't like that, just shoo me away." And she said, "No, you don't understand." She said, "I don't have anybody, and I haven't had anybody in years. My husband died when I was fairly young. We have no kids. All of his family's gone. All of my family's gone." She said, "For the last 10 years, nobody has touched me." She said, "You came to church and you put your arms around me." She said, "I haven't heard a thing you said in 2 years. I just came for the hug at the end. I don't care what you do up there." You know, you could give out, you know, diamond rings. It wouldn't matter to me. She said, "Imagine that, 10 years. And every week, you're the most exciting thing that happens to me." You know, you and I don't think about that. We've got family and we got kids, maybe grandkids. You know, they're starting to do all kinds of things. They're doing everything. Christmas time's rolling around. You know, we got friends that are, you know, a bunch of folks are coming over doing all that kind of stuff. Somebody told me that their gathering now is up to 54 at Christmas time. Imagine being the person who has nobody. You know, you don't have any kids. You don't have any family. Nobody has bothered to reach out and hug or even touch you. The only time you say anything to anybody is at the bags, you know, at the grocery store when they say, "Do you want plastic or paper?" Imagine that. But there are folks that are like that. This is a really tough time of the year. The reason we've chosen lonely people is because this is a hard time. More people commit suicide now because of loneliness than anything else. Maybe a simple thing like giving a hug to somebody can make a difference. Maybe you can say to somebody at the grocery store, "I saw you. You had this kind of dressing. I like that, but I also like this." Or, "Gee, you know, have you ever tried that? My name's Joe." And just, you know, be amazed what a simple touch can do for folks who are alone. And don't think because you see them every day, they're not. Some people work in a whole group of folks and they've never gone out afterwards with a single one of them. They've never known them any place except in the workplace. There are lonely people that surround us all the time. Will you bow your heads with me as we pray? Gracious Heavenly Father, in your infinite wisdom, you give us people. Lord, when we look back at Adam, the first problem Adam had is that he was alone. When you created woman, you put us in relationship one with another and solved one of our most basic needs, to have someone around. So, Lord, in this holiday season especially, we pray for those who have very few and for those who have none, who kind of go through this season hearing about family and hearing about friends and realizing that it has nothing to do with them. Lord, I don't know where we see lonely people, but open our eyes to be more responsive in this season, to recognize them, to say to them just a simple word, to offer a handshake, told to bag of groceries, to walk with them to their car, to give them a hug. Lord, you have called us to be your people. And the most basic need all of us have is to be with somebody else. In this season, Lord, help us to see those who are in need of your presence, in need of someone to walk with them. We ask these things in the name of Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We have children headed off to children's church. The door's open over here, or we'll be shortly. There she is. All right. Don't the rest of you wish you could run like that? When was the last time you were so excited to come to church you wanted to run? To be like that again. All right. You know, and they get goodies over there too.
I got some leftover Halloween candy. All right, we're going to continue singing with hymn number 240, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Offerings the way they used to be done, but then we've never done offerings the way they used to be done. when priests were still here and in Isaiah's time, the priest went and sat in the marketplace. And you brought 7 or 10 or 12 or 15, however many goats, and they'd look at you and smile and go, "That's good news. Take those 10 and sell them. And oh, by the way, it's really only 9 because we'd like for you to give that other one to the church." It's been commonplace for the church to ask for money in all kinds of different ways. We don't quite demand it like the priests used to. Now we have baskets on both sides, and there's some kind of little that deal where you put it up there and, you know, put it on the, and everybody in the first service knew exactly what I was talking about. Okay? It's a little thing with dots and squares. I don't even know what it means. My daughter says, "That's okay, Dad. You don't need to anymore." My finance guy said, "You don't need to anymore. You're old." And I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "You're 72. Good news. We'll pay the church what you want. You don't get taxed on it." So I don't have a thing to do with giving money to the church anymore. My guy that sends me money so often, he just sends one to the church every so often. And I don't get taxed for it because I'm 72 years old. I don't know how you give to the church. I do know that part of the reason for that is not just so that we do things in this community. It's for you to remember every place you go, everything you do, God's present with you. The purpose of the priest going to the marketplace wasn't to say, "We're taking the tithes from you." It was to say, "This is the marketplace. This is where you live your life. God's present, even in this place. Whether you're aware of it or not, God walks with you every day. And part of the reason we offer that tithe, we offer our offerings, is simply to remember for ourselves, God, I haven't forgot you. I know you're here. And by the way, thanks that through this, we touch this community and bless those around us." Will you bow your heads as we pray? Gracious Heavenly Father, we do give you thanks for the opportunity to present to you tithes and offerings in whatever fashion we do that. Help us to know, gracious Heavenly Father, that you are always in our midst and that you are never distant from us. And those things which we present and give to the church, you multiply and grace this community that they too may know of your presence. Bless the offerings in all the forms they come, for we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Waiting for a king.
the 17th of December is the cantata, correct? Somebody said it was wrong in something, so I'm just letting you know what you heard today. There'll be a whole lot more of on the 17th. You'll want to be here for that. December 17th is the cantata. You know, there are some seasons of the year that are easy to preach. Lent is one of those seasons. It's easy. You know, we're remembering that we sin. The reason Jesus is on the cross is because you and I mess up on a regular basis. Easter is an easy season. He's resurrected. All the meaning that goes with that. It's an easy season. When I was a kid, we learned all the rest of them, Pentecost and Epiphany and all the rest of them. All of them to me seem easy to preach, even Kingdom Tide. You know, it's that time in the... It has absolutely no meaning in the church year, except we couldn't think of anything else to call it. So he said, Kingdom Tide, when you can preach about anything. You know, what it's like to be a part of the kingdom of God on earth, and what's it going to be like on the day when we actually enter into the kingdom of God for forever, in our forever homes. All of those seem easy. Advent has never been a good season for me to preach. Harry said, can you preach Thanksgiving? I said, sure. And he said, by the way, I need to go see my mom, so can you preach the first Sunday in Advent? And I smiled and said, yes. And I went home and I said, what is the matter with this man? Advent's a season when we're supposed to remember the decades, the centuries when the people of Israel remembered that God somewhere way back promised that he would be their God and they would be his people. But they didn't see that in reality. What they saw in reality was they wandered around and became like everybody else. They weren't God's people, and God only periodically showed up. For you and I today, it's a time of preparing our hearts for the coming of the promised presence that God gives to us when he takes up residence in our lives. We no longer live as the Jewish people did in centuries before us, wandering the earth, doing whatever. Now, because of the presence of Christ, because he has left with us the Spirit of God that dwells within us, we live in intimate contact with a God who is always there. Jesus has come and removed sin from our lives, and allow the presence of the Holy Spirit, the very essence of God, to take up residence in your life, in my life. This morning's scripture is Isaiah 64:19. I apologize that I struggle over the reading. This isn't the verse that it's not the version I did. And so there's some hard words in here that I didn't practice ahead of time. Isaiah 64:1-9. On that day, would you tear open the heavens and come down so that the mountains would quake at your presence? Now, folks, they remember that. When Moses went up to get the people stayed down below, and they were so afraid because the presence of God so filled the mountain that it moved under them. As when a fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we didn't expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do the right thing, those who remember your ways. But you were angry. We sinned and you hid yourself because we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean. And all of our righteous deeds are like filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf. Our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us. You have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. And yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. You are our potter. We are the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord. Do not remember our iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. The Old Testament occupies 39 books. It's written over about 1,500 to 2,000 years. And the basis of it all goes back to that story of an Adam and Eve. They sin, and God comes looking for them. They sin, and God comes looking. Now, you know that Adam and Eve knew God because they talked to him every single night. He comes looking for them because they don't show up one night. They remember the sin that they created, and they don't show up. They're afraid of him. But God comes looking. You know, the rest of the Old Testament is just that story told over and over again. It's a prayer for the people to remember what's happened. When I first read the story that he gave, I looked at it and I said, it's the story of Adam and Eve. They knew God and went away from him. And he had to come. It's the story of Abraham. He knew God, but he left him for a while. God had to come find him. It's the story of Isaac. Tell me that Isaac doesn't know who God is. His daddy's put him on the altar, strapped his hands, and it's the voice of God who comes and saves him. Tell me Isaac doesn't know who God is. But he leaves. He doesn't do everything he's supposed to do. God has to come and find him. The same is true of Moses, Noah, of all the rest of them. In every single case, God knows the person. And they wander. And God comes to find them. And part of the problem is, it's been so long since we heard from God, some of us don't remember him. We've drifted so long, and it's been so many years since the voice of God was heard, since the mountains trembled, since we knew the presence of God. We've more become like his enemies and live the way they live rather than the way God intended us to live. But this is a prayer of hope. Verses 8 and 9 pause. And go, God, remember when you made us? We were called your children. We were made in your image. Now, I'm kind of thankful that's not the case today. I have two girls that, if they were made in my image, would have become pastors. Because, you see, in Isaiah's day, whatever daddy was, that's what everybody in the family became. Daddy was a shepherd, they became a shepherd. If daddy happened to be a tailor, then they learned to sew and trade in cloth and do that kind of thing. If daddy was a priest, they became a priest. One of my daughters is a school teacher. Well, she was. Now she's become an administrator. She's an assistant principal, and her job is the disciplinary part. So she calls a mom up and says, Junior was in a fight today. He's at home with you for 3 days. He's not welcome at school. She also has to sit occasionally with a police officer and say, he's yours at this point. Call the family and say he's yours because he brought something to school that's not only against school policy, it puts him in problems with another authority. She has to say, you're not welcome back here. I got to say, my daughter wouldn't do well as a pastor of a church. She really likes her job. I just can't see her coming to some of the choir folks and saying, you know what, you ain't cutting it. You know that note that you made? Well, we don't need that note anymore. I can't see her coming to one of the volunteers and saying, you know, I don't think that's going to be, you know. And then my other daughter is a little younger. She's become a surgical tech, which is perfect because she has ACD really bad, folks. She doesn't do well with things that are not in order. I was sitting back there between services and I looked up, and don't y'all do this to the worship people, but you know, I was sitting there thinking about this pine tree on this side doesn't stand up straight. It kind of leans a little bit. It would drive my daughter nuts. One of her surgeons reached across the table where the patient was and took something off of her table. Now that's her table. She slapped his hand. Here's this surgeon, you know, bringing something over and smacks his hand and says, "No, sir, that's my table. You don't touch my table." And she's serious about it. And some of them now have grown to like that because they know I don't have to do that. I can just say what I want. And if it's the wrong, she's told the surgeon, "Nope, you don't need that one. You need this one." And he'll say, "Hand me that one." And so she'll hand him the one he asked for, and then she'll hold the other one and wait. And won't hand it to him. She'll make him ask for it. I don't think she'd have done well as a pastor of a church. I just can't see her at some of our meetings doing that. You know, there's some folks that I don't think would do well if their hands got smacked in the middle of a meeting. But in Isaiah's day, if your daddy was, then you were. And Isaiah says, remember, God, we are your children. We are supposed to be like you. Oh, yeah, we've wandered. Oh, man, have we wandered. We have become like the people that hate you. We've become like the very thing that we want nothing of. God, we are your children. Remember that. Look past the sin that's become so prevalent in our lives and treat us again like your children. Remember, we were made to be like you. We can't do that on our own. The coming Messiah, the answer of the loving Father, how does God do this when you and I can't do it for ourselves? The answer from God is, I'll send a son, and he's going to come and he's going to live among you. And you'll see what it's like to live as I would live if I were in your place. And oh, by the way, when he leaves, I did promise to be your God and that you would be my people. And I did promise to never leave you. So when my son returns, he's going to leave another with you. The very Spirit of God, the essence of God, and I will take up residence in your life. And no matter where you go, no matter what you do, I will always be with you. Nothing you can do or run away from it. Nothing make it more difficult. I will always be there. Today we start the first day of the brand new Christian year, and we remember we were created to be the children of God. We can't do that on our own. Lord, we have left the way he taught us, haven't we? We've all found ways to do that. Some of us in little ways, some of us in huge ways. It doesn't make any difference. It doesn't matter how far you've wandered or what you did. You were created to be a child of God. That image will never leave you. God will always look at you as his child and long for the day when you long to be his again. We become like shriveled up leaves, don't we? blown away by every wind. We begin a new year remembering that Jesus Christ came, the very proof that God promised and God fulfilled. And that when he left another. On the night in which he was betrayed, he took that bread and he stopped. And he said to his disciples, "This is my body, broken for you." You want to know what happens to sin? I take it away from you. I remove it. "This is my blood poured out for you." You want to know what happens to sin? Watch tomorrow when I hang on the cross, the blood that I drain. It's so you don't. Oh, and by the way, in a few days, I'm going to be gone forever, he tells his early disciples. You're not going to see me anymore. But don't be concerned, because I'm sending another. The Spirit of God, the very essence of God, to take up residence in your life, to live in you now and always. You will be God's people, and God will be your God. And how far you wandered, doesn't matter. How many years, doesn't count. Today, you are the image of God, and God has come to live in his children. On that day in which Christ sacrificed himself, he reminded the disciples in a very real way they would become the carriers of the presence of God. His flesh would be gone, but their sin would be gone, and they would live in the presence of God. And when the supper was over with, he took the cup. And he gave thanks and he gave it to them and said, "Drink from this, all of you. It's the blood of my new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." You know, the old covenant's pretty tough. There's no room for error. In the new covenant, there is no error. God has come to live in you. Christ has come and takes away sin, iniquity, whatever you choose to call it. And the presence of God lives in you. I'll ask those who are coming to serve communion would come that I might serve them. Ladies. The body and the blood of Christ given for you. Don't go away. The body and blood of Christ given for you. The body and blood of Christ given for you. The body and blood of Christ given for you. Don't go away. Don't go away. What do you say? Blood of Christ. There you go. I'll ask the choir will come first. And so if you'll come, we might serve you. And lest you think I have absolutely anything to do with this, this is the gift of Christ. It does not matter whether you're a member of this church or not, or a member of any church is immaterial. If you're in relationship with Jesus Christ, he invites you to come, either the side aisles or down the center, whichever is your choice, and then back. I tried to give the first service directions and it got worse, so I'll let y'all just figure it out, okay? The set, come, receive Christ. Mm-hmm. If you are in need of being served there in the pew, if you'll raise our hand. Joanne, I think, are you doing that or somebody? Okay. Yes, ma'am. If you'll raise your hand, we've got somebody who will come to you. You know, I remember as a kid growing up, there was always that one person came running out of the kitchen at the last minute because she was busy doing something. don't quit the line yet. She was ready to come. Will you bow your heads with me? Lord, we give you thanks for the grace of your Spirit that fills us in new and fresh ways. Bless and anoint us, for we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Please stand together for our closing hymn, number 211, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel.
Lord,
Will you reach up with your hand and take the hand of God? Remember that wherever you go this week, God is present with you. There is a world outside which still does not know that and needs a comfort, needs to find the one who walks with you forever. Go and know that the blessing of God goes with you. Amen.